Now, can you hear me? Well, okay, let's continue. I mean, from the questions I heard today, it means like people is understanding what I'm saying. But the good thing is, I mean, I forgot to mention some important issues, like one lady asked me how I can get less uncertainty or errors in the model. This is a longer process, it's model development. Model development means that you have to improve, for instance, representation of some processes. That will depend on the mathematics and also the supercomputer time you have available, because most of these models are running supercomputers. Okay, so model development is a process that keeps going on and on and on. The uncertainties are going lower and lower, but they're still there. And what you see, for instance, in there, is 2013 and 14, the fifth assessment report of IPCC was produced. Actually, it was printed, I would say, and released, because it was produced 2 years in the past, before that. Okay? And there was the fifth assessment report, AR5. The other one used to be the AR4, fourth assessment report published in 2007. So there is a difference between one and another. Okay, so the generation of models in use, for instance, they include changes in methodologies, which means basically improvement in some physical parameterizations. I mean, people who work with climate models, sometimes they will see that if you improve your model quotation, sometimes what you get is not what you are expecting. You see? So you improve the mathematics on one side, but if you don't improve the other that you don't know, perhaps your improvement will be very, very low. But besides the evidence, it's not just the models. The models are for projections, but besides the evidence, the IPCC, fifth assessment reports, they use, for instance, paleoclimatic data, different data sets that were not available before that have been released to the public, and also the issues of confidence, likely, unlikely, very likely, some way to qualify that the knowledge we have. For instance, it's likely that temperature will increase. It's very likely temperature will increase. With likely and very likely, there are some differences. Okay, and we have a longer record in temperatures, oceans, heat content, less negative aerosol forcing, reduced recent warming rates, and methodological changes. So different lines of evidence, not just the models, but lines of evidence. For instance, this is an example. What has changed from IPCC fifth assessment report in relation to sixth assessment report? It's almost 6 years of difference. Greenhouses continue to increase rapidly. Uncertainty in range increase is now we are accounting for processes that we didn't know before. So when you start doing deep analysis on something, you find things that you didn't know before they were there. So it makes difficult, for instance, for somebody working with model development, one person work. It usually has to see a team of people working. Team and climatologists, because they know how the climate should be. Team as programmers and computer science people, because they know how to, I wouldn't say manipulate, basically, but how to work and develop the programming of that. And now we have a best estimates of aerosol cooling that we didn't have before through satellite data and also from different model techniques. So what it comes from the IPCC fifth assessment report, I think perhaps this is one of the first, the most known figure of temperature changes from 1850 to 2012. You see the warming is a 0.85 plus varying between 0.65 to 106 degrees. This is the uncertainty, it's the plus minus something, okay? And in the most recent years, from 2003 to 2012, this warming is even higher. So depending, for instance, you want to see, okay, I'm working only with this part. It's the warming. But what happens if you work only in this part? You don't see warming, you see cooling. But what happens if you work with this part? So at the end, this is sets and ups and downs. But when we have one clear tendency, it's basically what the warming shows. And the different lines, they show different data sets. Okay? The HAT, here is the Hadley Center from UK, MBLOST from United States, and GIS, God and Institute for Space Studies in New York, but all of them, they show the same tendency. There are some differences one year to other because of the difference in the assimilating of data and the modeling, okay? And in terms of decades, meaning that before was year to year, now this is in terms of decades. You see that the last decade has been the warmest one, okay? Going from 1850, so it's basically out of scale. No, I wouldn't say out of scale, but it's really the warmest one. It's very likely that the last 30 years period was like the warmest 30 year period since the last 1400 years, medium confidence. You see, likely and confidence. That's the way the IPCC works. I mean, wherever it is in a statement, it has to be assessed the likelihoodness and also the confidence on that. That's just to give you some example. For instance, you have to plan something. You say it's very likely. Well, that's good. Medium confidence, well, it may be 1400 years. We don't have data from the year 1400 or 1500 or 1800. Actually, 1800 is few data available rainfall, but not that much. So that's the reason why we cannot say it's absolutely right. Okay? There is always some sort of likelihoodness or confidence. It is something that any natural science they have. And this is just the average of the warming from 1901 to 2012, based with relative to 1961 to 90. Positive, red, increase. Blue, negative, decrease. Purple is the warmest. And you see, for instance, southeastern South America is the warmest in the southern hemisphere. You see in Africa, you see in northern United States and Canada and northern Europe. Basically, everywhere is red. See? And what's the conclusion of IPCC based on this kind of analysis? Warming of the climate system is unequivocal. Okay, so the warming is there. We proved that the warming exists. We didn't say who is responsible. Just say the warming is there. The picture is there. The data is there. I mean, these are observations, not model, observations. Not paleoclimatic indicators. So we're talking about observations. Okay. And then another way to see this warming, okay? It's the same, similar to the one with the decadal, but just showing another different way. You see, the farthest goes into the left is the warming, and the decade of between 20 and 2012 actually was one of the warmest since the very beginning of the records, which is 1850. And in several of the data. For instance, I took one example of the Sahel region in Africa. The Sahel region in Africa, they have been suffering since the middle 50s a very drought situation, starting in the 50s, and then it really get worse in the decades later. And now it seems like it's recovering, but it's still on the negative side, but it's still negative. And this is a semi-arid region. This is the worst case scenario. We are worried about Northeast Brazil, that we have a similar situation of 50 years drought in Northeast Brazil, which actually will be a major, major impact in Brazil because the most vulnerable population lives in there. But one of the things in there, for instance, this trend, it goes from, let me see, it's the recent decades. Okay, when you see this, blue side means like rainfall is recovering. Okay? Rainfall is recovering. This is an anomaly. And it's still on the negative side, but it's less negative. But just taking from the last 20 years of data or so, rainfall is recovering in that region. Okay? But this is several things you can study. For instance, this is rainfall. These are rainfall trends. But on the other side, we study convection, for instance. This is the number of mesoscale convective systems, MCS, in the region. It has been increasing there based on the temperature of the top of the cloud, which is actually very, very cold. And all of them point in the same direction. Convective is increasing, rainfall is increasing. It seems to be like rainfall is recovering while in there. It's still on the negative side, perhaps close to the zero anomaly, and perhaps in the next 10 years or so will pass. But this is the typical example, perhaps the best example of a climate change in there. because at the 50 start rain stops and people in there got desperate, start deforesting everything, and we basically cut one of the sources of moisture, which was vegetation. So it was something that was started by natural processes and then was amplified by human activities. Okay? So this case of the Sahel was considered perhaps the first experiment, a natural laboratory, what could happen. And this is was a semi-arid region, and many, many millions of people were affected. Okay. Then, according to the IPCC, depending on the data you have, these are the trends of warming from 1880 to 2012, plus minus something, which is the anomaly. This is trends per decade. So depending on the data, say, you may find small differences. But at the end, the tendency is always positive. And you can see that from 79 to 2012, for instance, is much higher than 1880 to 2012. So basically, the recent years have been the warmest one. And this goes to 2012 because of the analysis of the IPCC data. For the next assessment, we're going to start next year, the sixth assessment report, we will have all of this updated perhaps to 2017, 2018. And we may see that the warming for that period will be even higher. Okay? Okay. On the conclusions from the IPCC. You know, the ocean warming dominates the increase in energy stored in the climate system, accounting for more than 90% of the energy accumulated between 71 to 100. The warming on the ocean has highly correlated with temperature in there. On global scale, ocean warming is largest near the surface and upper 75 meters. Okay, going down, the warming is still there, but it's lower. Okay, it depends. Most of this data is available from buoys. It actually provides some sort of levels, even 100, 200 meters. And the instrumental biases has been identified and reduced. One of the good things, whenever we have more data, new instruments, we are able to reduce the biases of the models, the biases in the observation, because most of the observations, they show bias. When you get a new station in there, you have to calibrate this new station with another nearby. Okay? It doesn't matter that you buy a lot of stations, put it in there with no calibration, you can get anything. So they have to be a calibrating process. So in terms of Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets, they have been losing mass. Glaciers have continued to shrink almost worldwide. And then you see the time series of spring and snow cover and Arctic summer sea ice from the two panels. Okay, some of them, for instance, in here, these are based on satellite data. The other is relying by basically on observations in there. And when you see this, for instance, in the top, you see the green light, the green line is the mean, but when you see this green shadow are the uncertainties. The largest green shadow area, more uncertainties. The lowest, less uncertainty. So in the past, for instance, 1940, 1950, the uncertainties are very high compared to the uncertainties in the last 10 years or so. They are still there, but they are lower. Okay? Uncertainty is something, like I said, that you have to measure. You cannot hide, or you cannot correct it and make it zero. You have to quantify it in something that is one of the major problems in climatology. Same thing with the sea level rise. It has been increasing steadily. There are not too many regions around the world that have data available since 1900. Most of them are particularly from the United States and Europe. And based on those data, it's high confidence that the sea level rise since the middle of the 19th century has been larger than any other period in the past. But we are talking about here of millimeters. Very, 10 millimeters, 19 millimeters, people can say, well, so what? It's very small, 1-2 millimeters. But if you multiply for the area, we're talking about a huge volume of water. Okay? And in terms of that, the impacts come from there. Not just for 1 meter is a lot. Perhaps it's extremely important for New York, for instance, or Dhaka in Bangladesh. But 10 centimeters could be enough. The city of Recife in Brazil, if you go there 10 years ago and now, the beach is getting narrow and narrow and narrow. Okay? And it's not because of the city is increasing. It's basically because sea level rise is getting higher and higher. Okay? And in terms of CO2, the recent measurements, I mean, we're going almost 390 parts per million, actually going close to 400,000. And observations, they show that increase. And together with that, we show increase, for instance, in the concentration of CO2. And here, the lower values of the pH. The lower values of the pH means basically acid condition, so the acidification of the ocean. Okay? And that may have impacts in the population, and particularly impacts on biodiversity. In terms of sea level rise, we see this time series from several places, New York, New Ling, San Francisco, Sydney, Fremantle and Mumbai in India. All of them, they show this variability from year to year. Okay? And you see this red line and red shadow, same with the blue. These are the uncertainties. Okay? And if you're going, just forgetting in terms of what happened, but the tendency is always to going up and up. And these are observations. Okay? So the few places when we have sea level rise means that the observations show or suggest an increase in the sea level. Okay? This is just increase in the sea level. It doesn't say increase on the storm activity or coastal floods. Okay? And some of the data shows, actually, those from the satellites, some of the extensions that we have. In blue is the sea level rise change negatively, it means that. And then the others positive, increasing. And most of this seems to be related to warm temperatures. The warm temperatures in the Pacific Ocean, the West Pacific, where Manila and Pago Pago are, warmer oceans get higher levels, cooler oceans get cooler levels. So we have perhaps this associated a cycle of the El Niño, perhaps the cool phase of El Niño, when we have cool sulfur waters. But you have the variability in different observations, different sites. I mean, even though with a large year-to-year variability, the tendency is going up. I'm not sure exactly how old is Antofagasta, how unreliable it is, but the tendency shows that. Okay, and these are a few places with data. And just the recent years from satellite. You have the GRACE and ARGO, and altimetry. And all of them, they show from 2005 to 2013, almost, the increases in sea level. Okay, in some years, it went down, but again, it recovers for the future. Okay, these are observations. And sea level rise shows actually high levels of uncertainty, even though with satellites, because satellites have to be calibrated with observations. And there are not too many observations to calibrate against satellite. Okay? Now, a recent paper published on the Nature by Barbier, 2015, they show that the tropical regions are the most vulnerable to that, to sea level rise. For instance, in Brazil, 40% of Brazilians in rural, low-lying coastal areas are living in poverty. So very vulnerable population are living in areas that potentially could be affected by sea level rise. Same thing in China. 40% of China's coastal wetlands are vulnerable to storm intensification and sea level rise. So you have the sea level rise up. You have the storms getting stronger. The waves, for instance, they keep coming deeper inside the continent. Same thing happens in Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, typhoons in there, they kill a lot of people because the city of Bangladesh is almost at the 0 meters. So any strong waves coming and sea level rise higher, more people, more parts of the city will be affected. And there are issues of monitoring and evacuating people because of typhoon and alarms and SMS and the cell phones and everything. But imagine that these populations don't have electricity. It doesn't matter. If you have a phone, a cell phone, without an antenna or electricity, it doesn't help. In Nigeria, coastal agriculture is vulnerable to storm intensification and sea level rise. half of Indians in rural low-living coastal areas are living in poverty. So meaning that you have a combination of sea level rise and storm intensity. And that's what happened in Santos in Brazil. Sea level rise plus an increased frequency in there are really being very impacting for the population living in there. And just to give you an example, I mean, there is, I'm not sure if it's a non-government organization, it's called Climate Central. If you go there, climatecentral.com or something like that, I'm not sure how climatologists are there, but they have nice animations and nice figures that I like to use for some amusement. For instance, this is the city of Rio de Janeiro. This is the, it's a Candelaria. It's Brazilian here, Candelaria, right? After 2 degrees warming. 2 degrees warming is basically very, very close to what we have now. So according to Climate Central, what could happen if we have 4 degrees warming? And then back. And then that. So these kind of things are really possible, but unlikely. Unlikely because of what? Unless there was a storm and bring all this water that floods this. If this is a coastal flooding because a storm, this is possible to happen. But not like the basically the sea level rise got up and then suddenly everyone will have to leave their cars and start swimming in there. But things like this, for instance, they are everywhere in several cities in the world. I took the one in Rio de Janeiro because I thought that was kind of interesting. Look at that. You see, this is, I would say, the artistic representation of something that could happen, but it could be either related to sea level rise permanently or related to a coastal flood during a storm. And after the storm is going, all this water will eventually go back to the ocean or will have to go through drainage. And if there is no drainage in the cities, I mean, it will last for several days. Okay? Just to give you an example, I mean, in Climate Central, you have more figures if you want to use them. Okay. Other of the variables that we use a lot. Perhaps as a climatologist, we are more interested in 2 variables, temperature and precipitation. You see? But for biology, we are not interested that much in mean temperature. We may be interested in maximum and minimum temperature. And in rainfall, if we study with floods, for instance, we'd be interested not in a monthly rainfall, but in daily rainfall, or even hourly rainfall. But rainfall itself is a very hard data to get. These are the trends in rainfall from the Climate Research Unit. And then from the Global Historical Climatology Network and the Global Precipitation Climatology Center. The one, the CRU, is a climate center from the United Kingdom. The second one is the United States, and the third one is from Germany. All of them, they use the same rainfall, but different techniques of interpolation. And you see, for instance, the trends in 1901 to 2010. South America, Africa, and parts of India, particularly in the CRU, no trends because there is no data. But if you go to the last 60 years or so, 1951, there, in Brazil, for instance, we happen to have more data in southeastern Brazil, in southern Brazil, and north part of Argentina. The Amazon basin and the northeast Brazil region, the data is let's say, more sporadic. And in the central Amazon, sometimes we don't have data at all. We have to rely on river data, which actually river data is available from the beginning of the past century. So in those tendencies, in those figures, you see regions that temperate tendency of precipitation, reduction of precipitation in brown, and increases of precipitation in blue. Okay, and the best coverage is in the last 60 years or so. So we may be able to explain the variability in the last 60 years or so, but not in the whole century. Okay, it's some of the limitations we have with the data. Okay, observation. Well, this is the same figuring before. And these are time series of rainfall from 1900 to 2010. For different regions, 60-90, 30-60 north, 30-60 south, and global at the end. So as a difference with temperature, we don't find a clear tendency of rainfall in the long term. We find what we call the decadal variability, meaning that some decades are warmer than others, but not a gradual increases in temperatures. Okay? You see, meaning basically that if temperatures are going up all around the world, in some places rainfall is not changing, rainfall is reducing, or rainfall is increasing. Okay? And like I said, most people are extremely interested in rainfall because perhaps this is the most important for agricultural activities, navigation, and other activities. And these are changes in specific humidity. I think somebody mentioned that I didn't refer to water vapor as a greenhouse effect. A water vapor is a greenhouse gas effect. It's extremely important. I mean, I didn't ignore it. Just when we are talking about the human-made gases, more like comes from methane and CO2. But water vapor is one of the most important. So it's extremely important because when a warming tendency, the water vapor seems to increase in the atmosphere, because you have more water into the atmosphere and more water coming in terms of rainfall, the intensification of the cycle. And most of the data available we have is in the northern hemisphere. As you see, for instance, the blue colors with the plus signs, which means that higher confidence. And some regions in southeastern Brazil, for instance, we have very light brown, actually perhaps not significant, but very, very lack of data in the continental regions of the southern hemisphere. It actually doesn't allow us to generalize things. But if you see in the lower part, for instance, you see this peak was approximately 1998, during 1998 El Niño, which actually was the warmest year in the 20th century. But the tendency in general, I mean, in some places, some decades are higher or lower, but in general, the tendency is to increase. So in warming temperatures, atmospheric humidity tends to increase. Okay. This is what happened, what we call the abrupt climate change. For instance, climate change will continue long after 2100. We said 2100 because most of the projections from the models goes to 2100. But the new models are running to 2300. But if you go to talk to a government, they say, well, I don't care about 2100. I want to know about 2040 or 2030 or 2050. Okay? And even worse, there are some adaptation limits that we must consider if we are thinking in terms of way to coping with climate change. Because if we are affected by climate change, we have to do something about it. For instance, if you live in a coastal region and you see that the waves are coming, perhaps you should buy walls to protect your property. Of course, there is going to a limit and with the wall doesn't help, but at least for a few millimeters that would be best. But one of the contributions, for instance, in this figure in there, the figure up there, most of the projection from IPCC shows in the worst scenario increases of sea level rise about 60 centimeters. It actually doesn't sound that much. But if we have a melting of the whole Greenland ice sheet, this sea level rise could increase up to 6 meters. Okay? Again, this is a modeling exercise. With models, you can do whatever you want. And we are assuming that they disappear and all this mass goes into the ocean, and then you see sudden example of that. If that happens, for instance, a decade, you would expect that a city like New York or Dhaka, for instance, could be affected in 1 decade. And 1 decade will be enough or not for people to adapt. See, perhaps it's not. So then when you see adaptation in the next days or so, you will see what are the possible adaptation measurements. One of them is the exodus. I mean, people migrating from one place to another, because there is no other way to support life in one particular region. Okay? So there are several, what we call the abrupt climate change. Things like this, for instance, could change whatever we project in the future, because what we project in the future goes more like decrease, very gradual increase, very steady increase. But with one of those phenomena like a melting of Antarctica and Greenland, we may have a problem. We may have something that we will never recover in terms of adaptation. Okay? Well, I'm sure that many of you have been working with extremes, rainfall extremes, temperature extremes. And each one defines extremes the way they want to. That really makes impossible the merging of several stuff. For instance, somebody in Brazil used, let's say, my temperature extreme for warming will be 35 degrees Celsius. But somebody from Peru says, no, it will be 27. And Colombia says, it's 25. And Chile will say, no, it's 19. We may have studies at a level country, but we will never be able to merge all of them to have a continental picture as in the US. So in 2010, the IPCC defined various extreme indices. And they have been used in several papers and even in the IPCC, because most of those indices are based on their own statistics, percentiles, and things like that, that easy to compare. You do this in Santiago, Chile, and in São Paulo, you can compare results because you are using the same index considering their own statistics. And most of those definitions are those, like warmest day, coolest day. Perhaps the most important is the one TN10P. I'm not sure if you can read that, TN10P, cold nights. This is TX10P, cold days. TN90P, warm nights, TX90P, warm days. Basically, warmer days, warmer nights. And what has been noticed everywhere, that the frequency of warm days is going higher, that the frequency of cold days is going lower, but you may have some very, very cold days in winter. Basically, what it means that winters are getting warmer. But you may have very, very cold days in a warmer winter. Okay? And then what we call tropical nights, warm nights, they have been increasing steadily, which means basically winter nights are not getting as cold as used to be. They are getting warmer. Okay? So there are several papers produced. You see, in the IPCC FIFA 7 report, www.ipcc.ch, you can download the whole reports of the chapter you're interested in. And you will see that in terms of extremes, the situation is really interesting. For instance, up there, this is a temperature anomalies of the warmest day. The warmest day, you see in red and brown increases and cool increases. The warmest day, for instance, look at that, 1951 to 2010, according to two different data sets, from the northern part and the southern part. The southern part is interesting because it shows the reduction in the frequency of the warmest days, but in the northern hemisphere you see an increase, and in the time series you see a change. From the 80s, it's going up. It was sort of stable from 1960s to 80 and before. From the 50s, it was going down. But it's important for the last 30 years or so, it's going up. This is basically the frequency of the warmest day. Okay, it's not the maximum temperature. It's the warmest day. This is one index that you can easily calculate. And in terms of the extreme indices, cold nights. What happened with the cold nights? You see the tendency is in red, mean going down. And the time series on the side means going down. Cold days, same situation. Warm nights and warm days. You see that warm days is increasing, but perhaps the higher increases is in warm nights. So what does it mean? That in the future, and now actually, you don't have to think in the future, in the last 50 years, 40 years, 50 years or so, The mean temperature may be increasing a little. The maximum temperature may be increasing a little also, but the minimum temperature was increasing a lot, okay? Which happens basically everywhere. The maximums are increasing, not that much, but the minimums are increasing a lot. So with the minimum temperatures, you can think in that. Well, warmer nights, winter warm winters, like for instance in São Paulo, we are at the beginning of a winter that seems to be cold, but temperatures at morning, for instance, was around 13 degrees centigrade. At midday today, I'm not sure how much we reach, but it was more than 20 probably. But at the end, this is just June, the beginning of winter. In few years in the past, we have seen several situations. May was cold, June was cold, July and August, which actually are the main winter months, are relatively warm. Okay? And that's been a tendency we have noticed in the past. And according to this, it's basically everywhere. So perhaps the most important indicator in there is the warm nights. And there are regions in the tropics with not much data, like Northeast Brazil, for instance, on Central Amazon. We cannot say much about that because we don't have data. We don't have data, there are two things. The data exists and is not freely provided, one, or the data exists and is full of errors and non-homogeneous that sometimes they didn't pass the quality control and we don't use them because it can produce anything. Okay? Perhaps this, sometimes it's the second one. The fact that you have data, it doesn't mean that you solve the problem. Sometimes you check the quality control and you will see that it's not worth it. It's better just to discard the data. Okay? Of course, you cannot say that to the director of Met Center, no? But again, as a climatologist or geographer, you need to know that the data you are using is the best one. Otherwise, you will get wrong conclusions for the wrong reasons. Okay? Now, in terms of precipitation. For instance, R95P means like extreme rainfall, which has been increasing in southern Brazil and Argentina. For instance, northern Argentina, we have proved that Uruguay also and part of Paraguay, including in São Paulo and Rio de Janeiro, the rainfall extremes have been increasing, particularly in summer. Okay? The total rainfall may be increasing a little or sometimes remains the same, but the distribution, the variability is very high. Same thing happens in northern Europe or sometimes in eastern U.S. And CDD, consecutive dry days. In some regions, it's increasing, in other regions, it's decreasing. But again, because of the lack of data, there are some tropical regions that we don't see that much. If we don't see that much, we don't know. It may happen, but we don't know how to prove it. Okay? So when you see gray in there, it doesn't mean that there is no trend. It means that we don't know. It may be. Maybe in the next 10 years or so, a country comes with a set data set that before didn't want to be released, and we may be able to start filling those gaps. Okay, but in the tropical region, it's a major problem now. Okay, and I think those figures I showed you before. Okay. There is a difference between prediction and projection. When we talk about climate variability or weather forecast, when we talk about prediction, basically the situation starts with an initial condition and then the system evolves. For instance, a cold front was detected in southern Argentina. This cold front moves to the north, reaches São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro, and we are following the evolution of that system. So we may be able to predict what could happen tonight, for instance. So it's basically evolution of the situation. With a projection, no. With a projection is something different. With a projection, you assume, for instance, if we have a situation when by 2050 all countries stop emitting CO2 and we come with techniques to absorb that CO2, is one scenario of stabilization. Scenario. Or if we go, and before it used to be called the Bush scenario, now it's called the Trump scenario, meaning basically, forget about that. We will keep producing CO2, giving jobs for everyone. Everyone will change car every twice a year and start cooking and eating and population growing. This is the worst scenario. Then for that worst scenario that we are assuming, we may have a projection of temperature. While we have the stabilization scenario, we may have a projection of temperature. You see? So it depends on the conditions you are assuming, not the real conditions. They are scenarios, possible scenarios. Like, for instance, you said, well, I want to buy a car. Well, let's wait until the economy in Brazil, for instance, until the economy improves. If it improves, if it would have this person elected, this economy will improve, I will buy my car. But if we have this other person elected, the situation will get worse. Forget, I'm not buying a new car, I prefer to start working on the old car I have and start buying some supplies and things like that. So, and 2 degrees warming has been considered, according to the Paris Agreement, as the threshold value for warming, meaning that our warming shouldn't go beyond 2 degrees. If it goes beyond 2 degrees, we may have impacts everywhere. We may have what we call dangerous climate change, meaning conditions in the climate that nobody could adapt. Okay? Because adaptation is something that we use to cope with the climate. For instance, somebody says, winters are getting warmer. And in fact, it has been getting warmer. Nobody has died because of that. You notice that, for instance, you have your heavy coats. You still use some days, but you don't use the whole summer. But you are protected. But what happens if you have an extreme cold wave? When the day after tomorrow scenario, I mean, no matter whatever, how many coats you have, you will die. You see? So these kind of maps, they show, for instance, precipitation at the current level of warming, approximately 1.5, at the 2 degrees warming, and at the 3 degrees warming. Same thing underneath for the hot extremes. Okay, so it means that the warmest day for present day, 2 degrees warming and 4 degrees warming, and 3 degrees warming, sorry. So what you see, for instance, choose one particular region. And you will see, for instance, with 2 degrees warming, you have the, I would say that this particular value of increase in hot extremes in percentage. And in some regions, when we have 3 degrees warming, we have more regions affected from that. So with those scenarios, we may have an increase in the extremes, particularly rainfall and temperature, and those are the lethal combination for natural disasters and for people dying. Because if you see a newspaper that say, like in Brazil, it's a lot. I mean, it's like, chuva mata 40. Rainfall kill 40 people. Actually, how rainfall can kill 40 people? People don't get drinking all 40 people. But if you have a landslide, consequence of a rainfall, kill 40 people. That's more real to say, impacts. Okay? So when we have this warming above 2 or 3 degrees, it doesn't matter the extremes. Okay? What important are the impacts. The impacts are higher. And when we have impacts higher, vulnerability is almost unlikely to happen. Very, very extreme, very, very expensive. Okay? And now, this is a recent paper by Mora et al. And Mora analyzes the hot heat waves. See? And it was interesting because in heat waves, the red squares shows that relationships between heat and mortality have been documented in red squares. And in blue squares, the heat waves have been studied only, but not related to mortality. And it doesn't mean that Bolivia, Colombia, or Brazil, they have heat waves only in those days. It may be that we didn't have enough data to populate that map. But you see in Australia, you see in in Europe, you see in India, you have in Eastern China, and you have in the US. So it depends on the availability of data to come with these situations. Because let's say, we are in a tropical country. Heat waves is not much of a problem, unless we have a freezing cold wave. Unfortunately, in São Paulo, few homeless people die in São Paulo because of temperatures were really very, very low, and they were sleeping basically on the street. But besides that, there are not too many studies that show strokes, for instance. There was one study In the port of Santos, that 10 people die as a consequence of a heat wave in March. All the 10 people were elderly, living in a home retirement home, actually. But because they were vulnerable, and when people from our National Institute of Health, which is called the Fiocruz, Osvaldo Cruz Foundation, they went to the hospital to see the death certificate. The death certificate showed a stroke. Stroke or heart attack. But they didn't say why, you see? So with this kind of statistics, it's almost impossible to relate those to a climate phenomenon. It was probably related to a climate phenomenon, but it's not written into the certificate. So this kind of data, for instance, doesn't help that much to identify the impacts of climate and health. It doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. Perhaps it exists and has not been studied, okay? In terms of daily climatic conditions, the number of days above one particular threshold. It's a threshold, it has been, according to medical community, 35 degrees centigrade. So if we have 35 degrees centigrade, we have a high probability of people being affected for a heat wave. We have the historical means observations. RCP 2.6, the RCP, you remember I said about scenarios, RCP, representative concentration pathways. I will explain that later, but the RCP 2.6 is the best scenario. What does it mean? That 2040, 2050, we stop emitting, and then instead of growing the CO2 concentration, it's stable and then go down, and the temperature remains below 2 degrees centigrade. That's the best scenario. And then we go to the worst scenario, to 8.5. Okay, so look at those two. According to the number of days above a deadly threshold, it doesn't say how many people die. It just says conditions that may affect people. And you see the differences. With 4 degrees, with 8.5, you may have large parts of the tropical South America, Africa, India, Southeast Asia, and even Northern Australia being, I would say, suitable for lethal conditions. With the 2.6 scenario, a warming less than 2 degrees centigrade, you see that that really goes lower. The region covered by these deadly conditions are lower. So with these kind of experiments, I mean, it's one of the things that you show to the people on the government, saying that if we do nothing, if we follow Paris Agreement, actually it's going to be very hard, but we may be this situation. But if we don't do anything, we will go in this situation. We have more people affected, actually. What does it mean? People get sick, they don't go to work, and economies start going down, people go to the hospital, health costs increase, people die. It's a major, major problem. This is a good example of this paper by Mora, published in Nature recently. And this is the kind of figures that shows these kind of things. You know, for instance, the changes in the probability distribution, the probability density function, 1951-80 and 81-2010. And we assume the normal distribution in there, but you can see that for the later period, the peak is moved to the left, to the right, actually, meaning that we are getting higher temperatures, daily minimum temperatures and higher temperatures. You can do it. I have done this for several cities, and the cities comes the same situation. But perhaps more important is on the minimum temperature. The maximum temperature is fine. So it means that, for instance, on the tail of the distribution, something that could be extreme in one period is no longer extreme in the other. So it's basically you're moving the tails of the distribution. So whatever was extreme or whatever was not extreme in the past now is extreme. Okay? And this is just the climatic factor. Why I say climatic factor? Because cities are growing out of control, population is growing, so you see more people vulnerable to these kind of changes now than in the 60s or 70s, for instance. So if you want to talk about climate change as a climate, this explains something. But if you want to talk in terms of impacts of vulnerability, at least the human factor or the biodiversity, and you will see that the impacts are really much, much higher. Okay? And this is the kind of distributions I mentioned before, but this is more like theoretical. The first one with the increase in the mean. The second one, increase in variance. The third one, perhaps, is the most likely, increase in mean and variance. And the one is the skewness, o sea, one for precipitation. When we have more heavy precipitation on the tails, means that this heavy precipitation on the tails, that they are least frequent, but very extreme. This is what we call low probability, high impact event. So an event that is very, very less probable to happen, but it happens, very, very impacting. Okay? This is basically our more worries in terms of climate change. Even climate variability, actually, in the present. Climate conditions are changing, and the distribution is changing. So whatever is before is extreme, now is part of the natural mean, basically. So whatever was not extreme in the past, now is no longer extreme. So it keeps going and going and moving and moving. This is the changes in extremes. TN90 are the cold nights. TN10P, cold nights. Then we have warm nights. Then we have cold days, and then we have warm days, whatever. What happened, as I mentioned before, the number of cold days and cold nights is decreasing. The number of hot days and hot nights is increasing. And it has been particularly higher 1979 to 2010 compared to 1950 to 2010. So, like I said, the last 20 years have been the warmest, and we have several evidence that shows these kind of things. So that's what I said. I mean, sometimes the extremes are more important than the mean. So you have to do an impact study of temperature in your fields. Prefer to work either with the maximum minimum temperatures, or if you have daily temperatures, daily mean temperatures, use these kind of indices. You will get more information from the data, because the data is there. You just have to play with the data to get the best you can get. So the data speaks. So you have to listen carefully what the data says, okay? Well, there was a figure in there in the back that you can get from the IPCC report, but I think more important to say that the consequences of that, of the IPCC report on extremes, it's very likely that the number of cold days and nights has decreased and the number of warm days and nights has increased on global scale. It is likely that the frequency of heat wave has increased in large parts of Europe, Asia, and Australia. They are likely more land regions where the number of haze precipitation events has increased than where it has decreased. The frequency or intensity of haze precipitation events has likely increased in North America and Europe. In other continents, confidence in changes is still at medium. Medium particularly because of the data. For instance, in Europe, I'm not sure, is anyone coming from Europe? Ningen? Ningen? Nadie? Because in Europe, as far as I know, it has been a very extreme warm temperatures, heat waves. Same thing in Spain and in Portugal. In Portugal, you see the combination of higher temperatures and drying conditions, fires in there. So the extremes are changing everywhere, year by year. Okay, and it's something you just access the newspaper and you will see that. But something that still we don't know that much is the frequency of tropical cyclones and hurricanes and typhoons. The phenomena is the same, it's just the different names. In the Gulf of Mexico and the eastern coast of the eastern Pacific, it's called hurricane. In Australia and in India, it's called tropical cyclones. And in Southeast Asia, China, Korea, Japan, it's called typhoons. The studies that show tendencies, they basically what you see in normalized units is the tendency of landfalling. Landfalling means that events that reach the continent. Okay? And look at what happened. There is no clear signal of that. If you take the last decade, you may see an increase. If you take the first decade, you will see a decrease. So it's not much of a trend on it. And see, we don't know that much of this kind of trends. This is the one of phenomena that shows in the future climate change projections, it shows high uncertainties. So as we see today, perhaps, in climate modeling, if we have some confidence in rainfall projections, we don't have that much confidence in hurricane projections because we don't know what's going on in the present, so we may not be able to show what would happen in the next 20 years or so. But if we go with weather forecast is different. With a weather forecast, we can forecast a tornado or hurricane, not tornado, a hurricane or typhoon in the next hour or so because we have the help of satellites who provide us monitoring. Different from climate change, with climate variability, we have monitoring. So you see what's going on now, and from this point, you see a possibility of scenarios for the future. I mean, assuming future, the next 6 hours or the next day or so. Okay. So, well, there are some things that I think are too complicated to show. But since I think you are going to get all of these transparencies, I just want to show some of them.
Ugh, cold.
Calculate wrong. Okay, well, these are the sea surface temperatures in the Niño 3.4 region. Anyone knows what is El Niño 3.4 region? Somebody who doesn't know what's El Niño 3.4 region? The thing is, I don't even have a map on that. But the El Niño is a phenomenon which is characterized by warming in the sea surface temperatures in the tropical region. Now, basically between the coast of Peru and the west part of the Pacific near White Australia. And to make studies comparable, we come with regions. For instance, let's say the Niño 1 plus 2 is the eastern Pacific nearby Peru and Ecuador. The Niño 4 is a region nearby to Australia. The Niño 3.4 is a region in the central Pacific. Okay? So if you take the temperatures in the central Pacific as an indicator of El Niño, for instance, Niño 0.4, we see this time series from 1950 to 2016. And you saw those arrows. Those arrows represent droughts in the Amazon region. Okay, droughts in the Amazon region. So what happened? These are the indicators. When we have positive sea surface temperatures, we have the orange color. When we have negative sea surface temperatures, we have the blue color. Okay. But now, in here, we have the tropical Atlantic sea surface temperature anomalies. Okay, one box nearby the eastern coast of Brazil. And you can say that each tropical ocean, they have their own modes of variability. Okay? The Pacific has their own mode of variability. You have an El Niño in the Pacific. The Atlantic, you have another mode of variability. You don't have an El Niño in Atlantic. Somebody came with the idea of Atlantic El Niño, but it didn't last that long. I mean, the idea. Because I think all of you know what El Niño means. El Niño in Spanish is the baby Jesus that shows up. The warm waters from the El Niño current comes during nearby Christmas. That's what they call El Niño. But somebody came later on with the idea of La Niña, which was the opposite. It was the cold waters. At the time, the name La Niña people didn't get excited about La Niña. Somebody came with the idea of the name El Viejo. Others came with anti-El Niño, but anti-El Niño sounded more like the Antichrist. So it came later, the idea of La Niña. Because El Niño y La Niña, well, different sexes, but in terms of sea surface temperatures, El Niño means warm surface temperatures and La Niña means cold surface temperatures. It's just a name, okay, just a name. We don't have names like this in the Atlantic, but you see, for instance, some years of drought in Amazon, were actually very warm years in the tropical North Atlantic. And some of them coincide with El Niño. Like 1998 coincides with El Niño, but other years don't. Okay? Meaning that, what I have to say is, each ocean has their own set of modes of variability. And rainfall in continents are affected by sea surface temperatures in the oceans. When sometimes these modes of variability converge, they are really very, very extreme situations, like El Niño 1998 was one of the worst droughts in the Amazon and Northeast Brazil, and the one of the worst floods in Southern Brazil and Northern Argentina, and droughts in Southeast Asia, droughts in Australia. So, and all of this is observations, is natural climate variability. Okay? This is not modeling. This is natural climate variability. Okay? And if we focus, for instance, this one, but if we pass a filter of 10 years, you may see, for instance, that some sort of U smooth your series. And we have in the Pacific Ocean what we call the Pacific Decade of Variability, meaning that 25 years of relatively warm conditions in the tropic, in the Atlantic, Pacific, sorry, relatively cool, relatively warm, and now is the problem, because now we should be in a relatively cold phase. But one of the signals of climate change is that this, what we call cycles, are not occurring anymore. You see? So what we know as a linear, stable time series, they are no longer. Because you see, for instance, the cool regime, the warm regime, now you see a cool regime, warm regime, cool regime is almost 2 or 3 years. So it seems like all this variation is broken and no longer that. And we don't know if this is going to be permanent or not. We don't know if then by 2020 or 2025 we are going to recover. Okay? So this is what happened in the current situation. That's the reason why seasonal forecasts are really getting difficult. Because with the normality or regularity of sea surface temperatures in the Pacific and Atlantic, our forecasts were, I wouldn't say less difficult. Not easy, less difficult. Now with this, are really getting more difficult. Okay? And this is the time when people is demanding more, let's say, accurate climate forecasts. So it's a debate. People demanding more of the best, and science cannot provide that because our patterns and what we know are changing. Okay? Just to give you an example of natural climate variability. And one of the consequences, for instance, what's going on with our pressure systems? We know in terms of meteorology, we have a high pressure system in the South Pacific, South Atlantic. Just focus on the first column, sea level rise. Okay? And then what happened? To have winds, we need your gradient. The pressure gradient is related to what? To warming differences. Contrast between ocean and continents that keep changing in summer and winter. So what happened? We have noticed, for instance, that in some cases the pressure in, like in the South Pacific or Atlantic, the pressure has been increasing. The anticyclone is in the same place, but the pressure has been increasing. And based on the reanalysis from 1871 to 2012, it's a very relatively short period. Okay. So it doesn't mean that, for instance, a pressure system that is in the South Pacific moves into the Amazon. It's there. Because if a pressure system moves into the Amazon, we may have a totally different climate. But if you move a pressure system in one place, you are moving basically the whole thing. If you change a piece of the chest, for instance, everything will change. And so far, in terms of climate variability, the circulation is in the same place. The winds are coming from the same direction. The problem sometimes with the intensity. Sometimes it's getting warm, stronger, sometimes it's getting weaker. Okay? And in this figure, it shows, for instance, the extension of the pressure centers. Okay? You see, for instance, the 120.5 hectopascals. And you see in South Pacific, South Atlantic, the expansion or the reduction of that, but in the same place. And the same thing with the Himalayas or North Atlantic. So the pressure systems are basically remaining in the same place. Sometimes the extension of the pressure system is moving up or down, but the pressure system remains in the same place. Okay, these are climate variability, not climate change, climate variability. Okay? Well, I'm not sure if somebody, is somebody working with Amazon here? Okay, so I think we have had in the last 15 years or so droughts in the Amazon region. Okay, in 2005, we have what many people call at the time the once in a century drought. Once in a century, one in 100 drought means a lot. Okay, but and you see the particularly December, January, February, March, April, May is the peak of the rainy season. December, January, February is our peak of the summer. March, April, May is the peak of rainfall in Manaus, in central Amazon. And the letters in yellow means dry years. And the red colors mean negative rainfall anomalies in percentage. Okay? So look at, for instance, 2005. These two. And look at the colors in 1983, 1987, and 1988. All of them were drought years in the Amazon. Actually, all of them, including the recent one in 2015-16 was El Niño year. 1982-83 was El Niño. 1986-87 El Niño. 1997-98 El Niño. 2005 and 2010 were not El Niño, but all of them were drought years. Okay? All of them were drought years in the Amazon, but you can see that every drought year in Amazon is different. Okay? In some regions, like in 1998 and even in 2016, the whole southern, central, and northern Amazon was affected. In 2005, it was basically the southeastern part of the Amazon. In 2010 was the northern part of the Amazon. So in each year you have a different behavior. So if you say, for instance, I'm going to study drought in the Amazon. Okay, there you have different droughts. All of them different from each other. Different in terms of the cause, will be El Niño, will not, or different in terms of the geography of the rainfall deficiency. Okay? For instance, the one in 2005, the southern part of the Amazon, the Madeira River, was very low. And when we have low rivers in the Amazon, we have a major problem because transportation in some regions are possible only by river. So people got isolated, and they have all type of problems with that. And the consequence of that, drier conditions, we have favoring fire. For instance, what happened? Fires in Amazon have been altered to severe droughts, land use, and increased frequency of fire. So if you combine land use changes with the possibility of fires, with the possibility of drought conditions, I mean, you may be able to favor forest fire season. And that's what is happening in the past. So what happened? Let's say, for instance, you start something. Let's say start with the tree death. Then goes to logging and clearing. Then when you log and clear, you have to burn whatever it is in there. And then you have a severe dry condition to aggravate things. And global warming could favor severe drought conditions more frequently in the future. So whenever we have fire, we have an increase in CO2 in the atmosphere. So basically a cycle in there. When we have more fire, we may have more increase of CO2, so we increase our levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. So that's the reason why one of the decisions in the Paris Agreement was to reduce deforestation, okay, to avoid the risk of fire, basically. Okay, you find that more on the working group 2 of IPCC. Okay, just give you some example of that. And if you go to climate models, actually, I will explain later what a climate model is, but some of the climate models, even though each climate model represents the processes, each meteorological center They have their own model that represents different processes in different ways. So you may have differences between models. For instance, here is the PCM model for the United States. It means what? Produces for the future more rainfall in the Amazon. The HADCM3, which Hadley centered, reduces precipitation, dries the Amazon basically. And the CCSM3, it's in between. So what happened? If you use this model, for instance, look at what happened with the concentration of moisture, maximum climatological water deficit. The drought, the red color, goes down. Okay? With the other models, it got more stable. So at the time, it came this idea of the savannization of the Amazon region, or Amazon dieback. Something that came in the 2000, by the UK Met Office people, but only one model showed that. And of course, it got a lot of attention, including in Brazil, where climate change could destroy the Amazon, and with that will destroy basically everything in there. But this is model dependent, so we have to be careful. When we analyze models, we have to analyze a large number of models, not just this one that shows one thing, or the other one that shows the other thing. What happened? We have this situation. Or what happened if, in fact, we have this situation? What happened if we have the other one? Okay, I'm sort of showing some of the examples that we're going to see later on. Okay. So in terms of observations, what conclusions IPCC had based on all types of analysis? The temperature over land has increased. Snow cover has decreased, glacier volume has decreased, air temperature and in the lower levels of the atmosphere has increased, water vapor has increased, sea ice area has decreased, temperature, marine air temperature and sea surface temperature has increased, sea level rise has increased, and ocean heat content has increased. This is basically a summary of what the observation show. Satellite, paleoclimatic indicators, and everything. All of this is consistent with a global warming scenario. So global warming is something that we are already detecting in the present, okay? Not in the future, in the present. In terms of processes and impacts, heavy precipitation events increase, droughts in Mediterranean region and West Africa increase, hot days and nights, warm spells and heat waves increase almost everywhere, droughts in North America and Northwest Australia has increased. Cold days and nights has decreased. And stronger tropical cyclones in the North Atlantic has increased. But that black arrow means that uncertainties are still high. Means that, for instance, what happened with the number of hurricanes in the future? They say that the number of hurricanes in total is reducing. But the number of hurricanes of category 3.5 is increasing. So we are going to have less hurricanes, but more powerful, according to projections. Okay? It may happen or not, we don't know. We hope that we know in the next round of IPCC assessments. But something we have noticed with the observations from 1850 is, in fact, that the number of hurricanes category 3.5 has been increasing. Perhaps not statistically significant, but has been increasing. Okay? Okay. So what would be the most important conclusions of the IPCC report? The warming of climate system is unequivocal. Since the 1950s, many of the changes are unprecedented on the decades to millennia. The warming is noted in oceans and atmosphere. The volume of ice and snow has been reducing. The sea level rise has been increasing. And concentration of greenhouse gases has been increasing. Now, in terms of the most, I would say, relevant and perhaps conclusion that creates a lot of discussion is the human influence on the climate system is clear. This is evident from the concentration of greenhouse gases, the different forcing, positive forcing, warming, and understanding. And it's extremely likely that human influence has been dominant cause of the observed warming since the mid-20s. This report was published in 2013. If you see the report in 2001 and 2007, 2001 they say something very light, you know, like it is possible human influence, but still uncertainties are high. In the fourth report saying the human influence is important and there are some evidences, but it means more like, you know, going, instead of going like this, they are going like this, you see. But at the end, the statement was really strong. It's there, the human forcing is dominant. And that actually creates a lot of gurus. The first one who decided to do something, the other ones too decided not to do because think that science is not enough to convince governments, for instance, to take action in front of this kind of phenomenon. But I think the evidence showed that. Okay? And there are a lot of figures in there. I mean, why there is somebody asked about uncertainty. Why is there is uncertainty in climate information? Like I said, you get the data, you have to process the data. You have to believe the data, you have to listen what the data have to say. Uncertainty in climate information stems to natural climate inherent in our ability to understand, for instance, to model climate system and understanding how future greenhouse gas emissions will change. I have one experience in the Amazonian of Peru when I went to do my work in there and trying to get some data. The Met Service in there basically closed the face, closed it on my face, so I have to go to the station and I bought a couple of beers to the guy who was doing the observations and I got access to the data. I think it was like March 18, and I saw that the forums were filled until March 30. So this guy was either inventing data or he was working with climate change. So that makes things, is really the data reliable or not? If you don't believe that the data is reliable, I mean, you will be in a big trouble. So perhaps what we can do, there are uncertainties on climate information, but we have first to take the data to do some quality control. If you find something different, check with the other stations nearby. Or if you find, for instance, an extreme rainfall event, check the newspapers or publications or something. With internet, you can find everything now. That if it really happens or not. Sometimes it happens. I remember when we checked the data from Piura in northern Peru during El Niño 1983, there was one day with 547 millimeters in one day because of El Niño 83. You cannot imagine that that rain is real in an arid climate, but it happened because in several stations shows this kind of situation. Yeah. So in terms of climate projections, we have confidence for regions than locations. So for instance, we said we call central US instead of Norman, Oklahoma, or Houston, Texas. Okay, so these kind of conclusions are, would say, less, more reliable when we talk about regions and not particular points. Okay, and we are expecting some sort of gradual changes in average conditions. This is the one we have noticed in the present, okay? Gradual changes. You go very, sometimes, non-significant changes, but if they are non-significant, it doesn't mean that they don't exist. They are there, but perhaps not as strong as compared to the mean, but they are there, so we have to start looking at them. So, just to summarize, natural climate variability resulting from natural processes, future emissions of greenhouse gases arising from uncertainty of the scale of future global emissions by human society. In the case of scenarios, for instance, we are assuming levels of development from the society when we have more release of CO2 of greenhouse gases and others less. Model uncertainty arising from incomplete understanding of Earth system processes and incomplete representation of these processes. If we don't know these processes, we cannot parameterize them and we cannot represent them in equations. So basically, we are ignoring them. And we may have problems with the model later on. Okay? So, and to provide levels of uncertainty, we have to calculate sometimes the confidence in the validity of a finding. For instance, you say temperature has been increasing, but is that really, is that so? It's been increasing a lot. It has been increasing a little. Talk to other people to see, check the theory, actually is going on. Maybe the temperature station was moved from one place to another, because sometimes it happens, nobody knows, but you will see changes because of location changes, not because of climate change. And quantify measures of uncertainty in terms of probabilistic terms. So like I said, uncertainty is something that you have to live with. You cannot finish with uncertainty. You cannot stop the uncertainty. We cannot hide uncertainty. It's something that we have to live with it. We have to quantify. Ideally, we would like to reduce it. Model development help us to reduce the uncertainties. But it's something that it has to be there, and we have to rely on that. We have to rely that model improvement will reduce the uncertainties. And we have to measure the uncertainty. We have to quantify. We cannot fit it anymore, ignore it anymore. And this is from IPCC, which actually comes with this level of uncertainties, likelihood in probabilities. Berkeley Center is 99 to 100%. Exceptionally unlikely, almost 1%. So several levels. Some of these attributions are based on experience. Okay? If somebody who starts working with climate, for instance, it will be very hard to assume this attribution thing. But somebody working, or a group of people working with experience, a lot of experience in some particular region, they may be able to be in a better position to define very likely, unlikely, or likely, or about as likely as not. I mean, those are English terms. If you want to translate to Portuguese or Spanish, it's going to be really complicated. Okay? Well, at what time are we supposed to finish? Hmm? 5:30. No. Okay. Just let me show you one example for tomorrow. I took it from the FIFA assessment report. And for instance, just to see, particularly this one, the warming hiatus, which it went from 1998 to 2012. It was a period where temperature sort of dropped, the increase, and sort of stable up and down. It was a natural cause, natural climate variability. People thought that perhaps it was the end of the global warming and the beginning of a cooling, but no. It was basically like this, stop, and then increases even stronger. Okay? Hydrological cycle. There are some regions that are already experiencing drought, so many changes in the hydrological cycle. So something that we are interested is first the warming hiatus, which is no longer, doesn't no longer exist. The observed trends in drought or likeliness, it has been happening more in several regions of the planet. The 1.5 degrees warming is one of the goals of the Paris Agreement, and beyond 1.5 to 2 degrees warming, we may be in a big trouble. We may be able to not implement vulnerability assessments and the vulnerability actions, and the impacts will be very high. And for that, if you want to study sea ice or warming or whatever, we will have to rely in models, either the 30-something models from IPCC or a subset of models, okay? So this is just to give you an example of some things that we are going to discuss tomorrow. Well, any question? One or two? Yes? The microphone.
It's not a question, but an observation. when in the Amazon, no, we said the Amazon is a particular cycle, no, and many researchers think about the Amazon is easy to study. It's not easy, no. When I study the fissure in the central of Amazon, is One professor from São Paulo University told me, oh, yes, you know everything about the fissure in Amazon, because the problem is the El Niño, no, and the flow cycle, no? I said, no, it's not easy, because the Amazon have a particular atmosphere system,
yes,
no, and it have many relations between the variables, no? The forest, the atmosphere, the ocean, and it's very complicated.
Yes.
No, and yes, it's just, I think the people need to look the problems with different eyes, no? And not so easy, okay, it's not everything is about the El Niño La Niña. No,
yes.
You need more explain and
exactly.
More studies about this.
Perhaps because of the size of the Pacific Ocean, the El Niño seems to be a dominant mode of circulation. But sometimes, like I said, the intensity of this mode could be like this and then suddenly falls down. But at the same time, the Atlantic mode of aridity could go higher. And the Atlantic has a direct impact on the Amazon. The Pacific is an indirect impact. You see, sometimes they both work together. Sometimes they just don't work together. But we have warm, wet conditions or dry conditions in the Amazon. So El Niño is one mode of variability, but it's not the only one that explains climate variability in the Amazon. Okay? Yes?
Yeah. Since Hadley circulation cell, it's going to extend, I wasn't expecting pressure systems to be remaining in the same place. So my question is, if in mean terms, their position is projected to change?
What I show were not climate change scenarios, were the variabilities. The 20-day reanalysis. So you wouldn't change, you wouldn't see that much changes in the Hadley circulation. But when we see the projection for 2040, there you will see the changes. I mean, the high pressure will remain the same place, but it will extend more. So meaning that the Hadley and Worker will be, I wouldn't say will be shifting, but perhaps will be extending coverage in other regions. But if we change in Worker circulation, the Hadley circulation also will change. So definitely there are going to be changes. Yes?
Under the warming scenario, you have shown that the moisture content will increase. So there is a possibility of increase in rainfall. And on the other side, there are some projection of drought. How can we explain that drought under the increased moisture content scenario?
Well, most of the models in warming scenarios, they show increasing moisture. I don't say moisture transport, moisture content of the atmosphere. But in general, when you want, let's say you want to do a study of climate change, you will be safer if you use an ensemble of models than one particular model. Because you may take one particular model that shows dry conditions. And you can say, oh, the Indian monsoon is going to be drier. But there is another model that shows more rainfall. So the idea is to work with ensemble of models. That gives you more like statistically significant results. So it's not good to rely only on one model. Particularly the outliers. You better work with the ensemble of models, and you will see perhaps more consistent changes. Or not. I mean, there are some regions that actually they still have problems, like, for instance, the El Niño. The El Niño, there is no consensus in the future we're going to have more El Niños, less El Niños, or more mega El Niños of 20 years or so of duration. There is no consensus. Okay?
So the reasons may be El Niño or some other climatic variabilities. Of the drought.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
I want to know what may be the reasons of more drought in future. There are some regions where more droughts are projected. So what may be the reason of the more droughts? What are the causes?
They are changes. The gradient between continent and ocean is changing, and that may change the intensity of the winds and the moisture transport. For instance, if you have convergence, but you don't have moisture convergence, you may be in a situation when rainfall is not good enough. Like, for instance, eastern Amazon, it shows a projection of less rainfall in the future. You see the winds coming from the north, but the moisture transport is reduced. You see? So for every region, the causes of drought may be different. But if they will have to do with changes in dynamics, changes in circulation. The rainfall change is basically the consequence of whatever change in circulation we have. Okay?
I deal with climate extremes, and particularly using the indices that you have shown for the climate change detection indices that you have shown. And when it comes to projection, I deliberately leave out RCP 2.6. To me, I perceive it as, I don't know whether I should say waste of time or making my work bulky for nothing, because I tend to see it as somehow unrealistic. Mm-hmm. Because going by the timeline, we don't see a scenario where the greenhouse gases can stabilize by the year 2040. What's your opinion on that?
The report was published in 2013. The work started to be done 3 years in the past 2009. At the time that these RCP scenarios came, it was reliable at the time to assume a low emission scenario with possibilities of stabilization and also what we call the negative emission, with meaning like mitigation techniques to start capturing the CO2. But now, years later, like you said, I mean, the current warming is almost 1.5 degrees. So it doesn't make much sense of having a 2.6, but we realize that now, not at the time it was created. You see, I mean, we used a 2.6 more like an academic exercise, basically, saying that this is the best scenario if we do everything on the right way. But as the way we goes now, it's very unlikely that 2.6 may show something real. 8.5 perhaps is more likely to happen than 2.6.
Quick question about the new scenario that's going to be in this September, I believe. You know, how are they going to be defined?
I'm not sure. I haven't heard about that. I know that the CMIP6 models are being implemented, but I don't have the details of the runs. I'm not sure if they're using the same RCPs or others. I think they're using the same, but I'm not sure. I will look into it, okay? Okay.
Thank you very much, Professor Marengo.
Yep.
And we'll see you tomorrow. Now we will take you to the bus, okay? So take your things.